Jesus Christ. Freaking in. Let's go get long shot attempted. Oh! Hello everyone and welcome back to the Blacktown Football Hour podcast. My name is Mark DiPoli. I'm joined by Andrew Davies, who is here doing some work. You've definitely seen his face around Blacktown Football Park before or any other of the NPL clubs, and you'll find out about why in just a couple of moments. We're going to ask him a couple of questions and find out a little bit more about him. Of course, we're going to go through our results. Plenty of rained out games in our association, which has made things difficult, but there are some Spartans results and some AOL results to go through as well. So we will go through those, we'll split it up between us, and I think we're going to have a really good episode. In terms of what you can expect to see in the rest of this episode, we had Quakers Tigers on from the Deploy PL2, if you do remember, about a month ago, talking about their push for promotion. Those two have still not played their game, and by those two I mean Quakers Tigers and Prospect in that grudge six-pointer in the push for promotion. Whoever wins that in the reserves and first can probably expect to have the best chances to go up into PL1 next year. You're going to hear the response finally from Prospect, who are currently the guys in first by a couple of points in the club championship table. So keep an eye out for that. The response is both hilarious and serious and very, very entertaining. In fact, it was so hilarious it almost threw me off script. In fact, I would say it did. So do stick around for that. Of course, we also have Quakers Juniors playing against Blacktown Workers this weekend in the match of the round, provided everything goes ahead. As you can see by the amount I'm having to squint right now, it's pretty sunny at the moment, so it's looking like the fields are going to be A-OK and open, so fingers crossed that everything is good for this weekend. I think, Andrew, we should meet you. So, First of all, thanks very much for joining us here.
No, all good.
Excellent. So, first time on the Blacktown Football Hour podcast, but it's not your first time being in sort of listening to it, or you know how the general gist of the episodes work, which is good to hear. Why don't you tell the people who are watching along, how long have you worked in football, and what are some of the jobs that you've done external to Blacktown and here at Blacktown as well?
I've been working in football past, say, a year or so. Before that, obviously I was playing, decided to quit that, just get into the whole football industry. So I started last year doing data scouting. I don't know if you guys know what data scouting is. It's just doing live stats for the games. So started that last year.
Who's that for?
Stats Perform.
Yep.
They cover all NPL 1 games, all NPL 2 games, women's included. So I started that last year. And then it continued into this role at Blacktown, Spartans/BDSFA, where I do the match day coordinating, ground announcing. So I don't know if some of you guys might hear me in the ground announcing box. I started that around in March, end of March, and continuing now.
So Andrew has some of the earliest mornings of anybody who features here. He's here at least an hour beforehand to make sure that everything's opened up, alarms are off, this and that sort of stuff. Yep. I don't know how he does it on such little sleep. I'm sure when he finishes on Saturday nights for those later NPL games and then backs up here the next morning. But he's been awesome to hang around with. He has a great football conversation. And I know he was a striker back in the day who scored plenty of goals. I think you said on that field over there.
Back when I was in the 15s, twos. Man of the match performance for me. I don't know if you guys remember Parkley, 15-2s. Yeah.
That was you. That was you scoring all the goals.
Yeah.
So in terms of what you're doing here now and for the next couple of weeks, can you explain what's on your plate and why you're here?
So pretty much I'm doing an internship at BDSFA. The general manager was kind enough to offer me the internship to do it here as part of my uni degree. And so pretty much I was told we're doing event coordinating, helping out with the event coordinator, helping out with Mark doing media, helping out with Mick doing competition management, so a bunch of different roles. So I'll be here for the next few months, just learning different roles and just getting into the football industry.
It's good because we already had a good relationship having worked on ground announcing and together in match day coordinating in some capacity beforehand. So when I found out Andrew was coming into the office to help me with stuff, help Mick, help Adam, and do a little bit of what Sue was doing, before she retired. I was very happy and knew that we'd get along even better than we were before, and he's been fantastic so far, and he's already worked pretty tirelessly. So it'd be great to have him here as he wraps up the uni degree, and he's going to be a much-needed resource in the busy months to come as we head towards the end of the season. So probably my couple of final questions for you as well is what are you looking forward to most in the next couple of weeks?
Many things. Even the whole events coming up, we got a bunch of got a grand final week coming up soon, so that's gonna be a very busy and entertaining week. That can include yourself, media, a lot of catch-up games coming up, but yeah, just enjoying it as it comes. Yeah, got grand final week, got events, we got team presentations coming up that we have to plan for. So yeah, it's can't wait.
Just as the sun comes back over, I thought we were out of the sun for a second. But just going back to stats for a moment.
Yep.
How does that work? So obviously that would come through on a website or app or something. Yep. But what are you doing? Like, how are you watching a game? Do you actually end up watching it for enjoyment, or are you really just there to dig deep and look at some stats?
No, definitely. I enjoy every game I go to, even though you might be getting a 8:30 at night game where it's freezing cold. There's still entertaining games, especially down in the MPL 2, MPL 3 games. But yeah, I also, so you're on your phone doing the stats, you're watching the game, and you're also entering stats. You get paid for it, and it's a lovely job. The stats go to whoever wants to buy them, the live stats, so whether that be betting companies, apps who might want the live stats. I know one of our partners is Google, Yahoo. Yeah, so yeah, it's a fun job. You get to go around to different venues as well. I've been to plenty of MPL1 venues with the big grounds. And yeah, you meet different people there as well. It's great.
Yeah, really good. My last question to you would be about where you want to sort of end up in the next couple of years. Of course, this is not just a stepping stone in that sense, but yep. This is just another job, and you can learn things here before you move somewhere else one day. What are you looking to do in the future? Does it involve football?
Definitely, it involves football. I'm not certain on a certain role, but anywhere in the football industry is very appealing to me. That's why I've continued to do the internship here and see what happens in the next few months.
Excellent. So it's been a pleasure to have you so far. We're going to read out some results here from our AYL to All Age to Premier League, of what we can, of what didn't get rained out. So I know you were here for the AYL Saturday games.
Yeah.
So I'm sure you can give us a bit of a rundown of how those games went. So let's go straight into our results.
Okay, no worries. So I was doing the ground announcing, and the results are as follows. Ploys played some midweek games as well, but this was on Saturday. Our 13s lost an entertaining 5-4 match. Goals either ends, but you can do what you can do. 14s won 2-0, so continuing their dominance at the top of the table, extending that lead. The 15s had a scoreless 0-0 draw. 16s went down by a singular goal, so unfortunate there. But I thought in midweek, the 13s won 7-2 against Nepean. Again, responding back to that 5-4 loss. Our 14s drew 1-1. Our 15s lost 3-0, unfortunately. And our 16s won 1-0 to cap off the night.
Yeah, that was awesome. So I think that 7-2 result for our 13s is probably the best result they've had of the season.
Yeah, definitely.
To come back from a 5-4 is difficult. And you know, knowing that you were so close in what was a 9-goal game, those midweek games were spread across 2 nights. So some of them were here on a Monday, and then I think there was a game on Wednesday next door at Wanderers. We have cursed the 14s a little bit ever since we had them on the podcast. It looks like their results they've been a little bit harder to come by, their big blowout results. So best of luck to the 14s as they finish up their season. Hope that the jinx doesn't last too much longer. There were some All Age 1 results that we can talk about.
So the All Age 1s, a game was supposed to be played this weekend, but unfortunately between Holyrood and Quakers Hill Juniors on the 31st, but Quakers had the forfeit, so that game has been given a 2-0 win to the GDSFA club.
Yeah, so obviously there'll be fixtures that go ahead this weekend, but the only result that we can give you that has happened since last week is that result that's meant to happen in 2 days' time.
Yep.
So that's the best we can give. Otherwise, no other results. Our Premier League.
So Spartans girls played on Sunday against Bankstown City. The 14s, again, winners, 3-0 this time. The 15s put 5 against Bankstown, again, scoring how much they like, whenever they want. While the 16s didn't have a game because Bankstown unfortunately had to pull their 16s team this season. The 18s were boosted by an array of 16 players, but they couldn't find a winner and ended in a scoreless draw.
So the 14s had to play their game, then back up for the 15s as well. 15s then played their game as well as backed by some of the really high stamina kids from the 14s. The 16s then had to move up and play the 18s. The 18s then had to move up and play reserve grade. And you can see where this is going. This is due to international duty and just that 16s game not existing, unfortunately. But really good results across the board. Is that it for our...
Yeah, that's it for the AY, for the Spartans goals, yes. And we're going to the...
Going to the women.
Reserve go?
Yep, so the women sticking with Spartans girls and women. We also played against Bankstown, 4-1 winners with a reserve grade, and I can show you the goals from that game right now. It was a fantastic victory. It was really good to be here and watch 4 goals go in. Even though we did go behind in the first couple of moments of that game, they responded really, really well. The first grade, however, did lose. I can show you the highlights of that game courtesy of NPL TV right now.
Down the right-hand side for the Lions. Now it's Danaskos tipping it forward, gets it back on the 1-2, has a shot and puts it away. Liana Danaskos, that was a beauty on the angle. Anna Norton could do nothing about that. And Bankstown City take an early lead through 8 minutes. Liana Danaskos puts Bankstown City in front 1-0. At the microphone for that one, the voice of Central Coast Football. Here's a chance for Bankstown City. Kulizakis liked the chance there from long range. Maya Markovsky back in the team today. That one comes off the post. Good chance there from Blacktown from long range. Markovsky gets it back on the right, sends it in. Nice ball to the back post. Oh, great save, Edwards. Outstanding save, Brianna Edwards. Only got one hand to it, couldn't do much more and parried it over the bar. Whips it in on the far post, heads there. Pinballs around and somehow bounces over the bar. It'll be out for a corner though. Jaber over the top. Found Edwards. Nice cutback from Siobhan Edwards. Still with it. Has a shot. Not a bad effort either. Forced a save out of Norton. And it comes from the right-hand side. Over the head and in. 2-0 Bankstown City. A lovely head at the back post. Over the head of Anna Norton. And again, she could do nothing to keep that out of the net. Danaskos. A chance for the Lions. Danas, it's Kulizakis who sprays it off the... In fact, I was going to say sprayed it off the side of the boot. She's won the corner. There's a chance for Blacktown and it's in! A late goal. Keeps them in the hunt. Ashley Crofts puts it away. Makes it 2-1 in favour of Bankstown City. Nearly broke for Tiana Jaber. Thought about the shot first time. Didn't quite get enough time to steady a shot. Koulouzakis gives it back to Jaber. Right edge of the box. Whips it in. Nobody there. Coughlin gets a head on it. Good save from Norton at the right post. Down the line. Coughlin has Edwards inside. She'll go herself. Cynthia Coughlin made the save. Koulouzakis tried to poke it home. Edwards tried to poke it home. Norton down to her left made a good save. Thew just chips it over the top to the right-hand side of the Blacktown defence. Finds Moreno. There's the final whistle.
Manly and Spartans in the reserve grade also played a round 14 catch-up game that was away to Cromer Park. This was last night, Thursday night that is. They were up 2-0 but unfortunately couldn't hold out. It ended in a 2-2 draw. Now, of course, there's one thing we haven't mentioned and that is the Premier League. As I might have mentioned it before I handed over to Andrew, there were no Premier League results, obviously because games did not happen over the weekend. So everything looks to be going ahead this weekend, touch wood. But yes, no results that we can give you. The results that I can give you, though, were from the Spartans boys and men. So, the Spartans boys visited Sutherland Sharks, which is always a tough away day, and it was a tough set of results. 2-0 losses for both the 13s and 14s. The 15s lost by a goal to nil. The 16s got the only win of the day, a 2-1 victory, before the 18s lost by the same scoreline. The men were to play Bonnyrigg at Bonnyrigg, but unfortunately Bonnyrigg pulled out of their game. That game did not go ahead. It's unknown when the rescheduled date for those fixtures are. Midweek catch-ups did happen on Wednesday night against St. George City, which saw the 20s play the final 3 minutes and then the second half of their game against the 20s from St. George City, because they played 42-odd minutes here about a month ago before that torrential rain, if you do remember, actually watched that game out. They held off to win 2-1 after taking a two-goal advantage in from that first month-ago game. Yep. The first grade, to be honest, they conceded to a pretty fantastic freak back heel flick down that end. To be honest, I was in awe watching it, and it sucks to go down by a goal to nil when a goal is so 1 in a million like that, but full credit to them. Now, I can throw that away, because, and I promise, as I always say, I will pick that up, and I always do pick it up. Let me tell you about the, excellent, yours has gone a lot further than mine, it's still going.
Might have to run after
that's,
that.
That's pretty good. I think you can take my position in the paper after this now, for sure. Now, in terms of the rest of the episode, obviously we've seen Andrew now, which is fantastic, and he's done a wonderful job, but the rest of the episode is going to look as such. So, we spoke to, I spoke to, like I said, the Quakers Juniors coach ahead of their game against Workers this weekend in the match of the round, so look forward to that. But really, Prospect is the one you want to watch. The response to Tigers, who were on the podcast a couple of weeks ago, and it was really a hilarious conversation I had with them. So, stick around until the end, and I will see you then. Andrew, thanks very much for featuring
me. No worries, lovely to be here. Thank you for having me.
And I welcome now Prospect. For our first and most important segment of the day, I'm joined by a couple of the Prospect boys who are pretty much the bookie's favourite, if you can call it that, to go up into the Deploy PL1 next year. They've had a bunch of fantastic respective seasons from their Premier, their Reserve and their 21s grades, and I'm sure they want to continue that for the rest of the games in the season. We're going to talk about their motivation for the final series, considering that it has nothing to do with promotion. We're going to talk about their grudge matches that they've had, a six-pointer they've got coming up in 2 weeks to the day. And just cover all the sorts of things that you haven't heard from them since we last spoke to Lee and to Peter specifically. But we're also joined by Danny, who features in outfield and in goalkeeper for the reserve grade and first grade respectively. Boys, thanks very much for joining us, by the way.
Thank you.
Now, let's just start first and foremost with the most recent game you guys played. So that was 19th of July, so you guys have been lucky enough to get out there. Can you tell us about that 3-1 win in first grade over the competition rivals, Eastern Creek?
Danny, you want to talk about it?
Yeah, sure thing. Huge win for us, especially in first grade. First time in two seasons we've actually beat them in first grade. So it was a monster day. We knew that it was a six-pointer, not only in the competition, because we've cleared them by 3 points in first grade now, but also in the club championship, we extended our lead to 7 points.
Mm-hmm. Now, speak to me about, if you can remember the reserve grade game as well, how was that for you individually, and are you finding are you finding outfield or in goal more enjoyable at this point?
Yeah, it's an interesting concept, keeping first grade and playing out in reserve grade. We just spoke off camera. We've got 44 goals between the front three in resis, and that night against Eastern Creek was no real difference. The boys were quality. I actually kept that night because our keeper was injured. But, yeah, they don't need me. There's plenty of goals coming, and 2-0, it finished up, but plenty of missed chances that night. Full credit to Creek. Their keeper made a few really massive saves.
The reserve grade only counts for 1 point when you win in the club championship. Obviously, three times that when you go up into first grade. That reserve grade side is probably one of the best we've seen in a number of years here. So, just to shed some light on that reserve grade side, what's made it gel together so well? If you want to touch on this as well, Peter, at some point, what's just made it click this season?
Yeah, I'll pass this one over to Pete. I mean, I've been playing, he's been watching, so he might have a bit more insight.
Sure.
Yeah, look, the team from last year is a totally different team. So we've recruited really well in that regards. The coach is there, Stan. He's the reserve grade coach, which is doing a fantastic job. But all the boys want to play first grade, so they're all pushing for the first grade spot. So that's what I believe that makes them want to play a lot better. But the unity that the reserve grade and first grade got, it's a bonus. It's like I said, I've told you before, it's one team, you know, and they don't care if they play reserve grade or first grade, you know what I mean? So if I drop first grades down to reserve grade, there's no issue there whatsoever, and vice versa, you know what I mean? So
good, excellent. Just while the mic's with you, and just touching on 21s, I'm not sure what your involvement is with the 21s, but they're also doing just as well. Last time I checked, they weren't quite top of the table, but they were there and thereabouts.
They are on top, yeah.
Okay, they are on top, yep. Excellent. So even though they don't go towards club championship, it's a good scenario that even younger talent is coming through when they're doing so well.
100%. When we picked the 21s team at the start of the season, we didn't pick them just for this year. We picked them for the following year. So we can... So these 21s can move up into reserve grade. That's the whole aim of it, because it's going to be players that might not play next year or not going to make the cut. So we're going to move the 21s into reserve grade. Not all of them, but there will be players that will be moving up. And then hopefully we'll try to recruit players for the 21s again.
Probably important to note as well with the 21s, you've had us on stream when we've used 21s in first grade.
Mm-hmm. And I haven't noticed a dip at all.
Yep.
So, I wouldn't, when that came
night,
on
that
to
night
the
we beat Mitchambury 6-0.
Yep.
Three. Our centre midfield were all 21s.
Yep. There you go. Oh, fantastic.
Yeah.
There you go. And that's something that they can implement for the next couple of years that they mentioned. Lee, I want to ask you, because the last time I saw you specifically, you were hampered by an injury
in the middle of one of our
streams. How are you since then?
I'm back.
Yep.
I played about 60 minutes against Creek, 70 minutes. I started. It was a grade 3 tear. Very painful. First time I've torn my hammy. I'm fortunate enough to be a part of a squad that they didn't recognise me not being on the field. There's leaders, there's talkers, there's senior players. You know, we've got such quality and such depth that it allowed me to rest for as long as I could. I think about 3-4 weeks ago I started running and playing. I played about 15 minutes against St. Pat's, I think it was. And then the week after played about 25-30 minutes. So I'm lucky enough to be able to just slowly progress into playing, you know, 90 minutes again.
Excellent.
Which has come at a good time, because it's the business end of the season and everything's on the line at the moment. We haven't won anything yet.
Mm-hmm.
We've still got a long way to go. 5 weeks, I think, 5 rounds to go.
Okay.
In football, that's an eternity.
Okay,
so anything can happen this week. We're coming up against a quality side in Oakville as well, who knocked us off at the beginning of the year. You know, they've probably don't think they're in a little bit of good form at the moment, but that's not to say they won't come firing against us on the weekend. So we've played some really tough matches against Oakville this year. And, yeah, I mean, we've still got Quakers as well. So 5 weeks of football to go.
Mm-hmm. So. Well, we'll touch on that in the, on that Tigers game in just a sec, because I do want to sort of end with that. But in specifically for your in these recent weeks, who stepped up in terms of the captaincy and leadership team? Who's come in and been able to direct the boys in a positive way each 90 minutes?
Well, Fozzie's there, Michael Fasano. He was our captain previous years as well. So me and him, we've always sort of led the team around. We're the older blokes, we're the senior guys. But, mate, we've got a whole squad of leaders. We've got Danny in goals, who, you know, is an absolute professional. We've got some strong, talkative leaders in the back line with Ranger and Dunny and Alex. So there's no shortages of leaders in first grade and reserve grade. We've got blokes who come up from reserve grade and play in first grade, and they fit right in. So, and this is what, you know, Pete talks about. You know, we're not 2-3 teams. We're a complete squad. So, you know, me not being there didn't make any difference. The guys were winning. They were scoring. They were playing beautiful football. We're very fortunate to have a good leadership squad throughout. So,
Peter, if we pass the microphone to you, I want to hear this from you very first, and then hopefully the rest of the... when I ask the other two as well, hopefully you aren't influenced necessarily by what he says. But I want to know, it is different from a PL2 perspective. The goal is promotion. There is then a final series, and there's trophies available, there's a presentation, there's celebrations, and there's something glamorous about that. But obviously promotion is the first and foremost goal. You guys are, like we said, tipped to do that, so provided that you keep doing what you're doing, you're going to go up. It's all in your hands now, so let's just say that happens. When it comes to finals time, are you going to treat that as the same as the league campaign with the same, we're going to put out a best 11, or are you actually going to sort of use that as a, the season's over now and I can try different things, I can experiment a little bit? What's the final series going to look like, provided things go well for the rest of the regular league season?
With promotion, that was the whole idea of why we all got together. Mm-hmm. Danny approached me and goes, Pete, we want to bring the boys over. I said, by all means, come over. Team gelled really well with the plays that we had originally. Our whole aim from 3 years ago was to get promoted. We almost did it last year, COVID hit, and then start again this year. Finals, if we get promoted, we get promoted. That's our number one goal. In the final series, look, I'm going to treat it as, and I'm sure the boys will do it too, our first and foremost is to get promoted. And I will treat the finals as, I don't think it's going to be fair to pull players off, you know what I mean, and rest them because we've got promoted. You've done the hard work all year, then the reward at the end is going to be whether we win the final or not.
Danny, do you think that if you guys do go up, provided the next five games go the way you want them to, do you think the boys might take the foot off the gas? Because there is a chance that those teams that don't go up then go, well, this is our chance to prove that, well, if we can beat these guys who have gone up, yeah, we can do it next year ourselves. So there's a bit of motivation and a bit of kick up the backside for them. Do you think the boys in that group will take their foot off, or is it going to be all guns blazing?
I think it's funny you say that. So if we're going to get promoted, and if somebody's going to beat us, they're going to beat us on a good day. We're not putting our foot off the pedal. We're not doing anything like that. If we get beat, we are going to get beat by a side that's deserved it on the day. Mm-hmm. We're there to win it. First job, as Chucky said, promotion. Second job, finals. So we get the first one done. We can celebrate it for 2-3 days. And we're stuck in hard work on the next Saturday. Hopefully both grades 1-2, straight through, take a week off. And hopefully then, yeah, we're tearing up for a final.
I haven't actually visited your home ground since I did a mini Roos video back there last season. How has training looked like considering all the rain that we've had? I just finished asking Quakers juniors this from PL1, but what's it look like for you?
I'd love to answer this. Can you have a guess when our last training session was? The year.
2012?
We don't train. Genuinely, we don't train.
Seriously?
So we've not hit a blade of grass all season. Our first training session / trial game was when we got pumped by Creek here in round one. And that's why we always start so slow.
Is that serious?
We don't train. Yeah. So we attempt to get training off the ground. We get like 5 blocks available. And we just know after 3 or 4 rounds of match fitness, we'll be there or thereabouts. So if we just weather the early storm, as this time of season comes, we're usually pretty fit. But yes, to all the kids out there, you don't need to train.
No, okay.
You definitely do. But based on, we got a lot of older boys who obviously have a fair bit of quality, and our young blokes are just super fit as it is, and the two just work together. And like I said, that's a genuine thing. We actually haven't stepped on a pitch for a training session this year.
Okay. Yeah. That's quite funny. I'm almost taken aback.
On top of that, we also don't play home games anymore, apparently.
No.
We haven't been at William Lawson for a while because it's been closed.
Yes.
And I don't think we're there again this year, actually, because our game this week's been moved to Marion Park.
Yep.
And our home game against Spurs has been moved to Marion Park. So we are now Marion
FC. The main field is down the bottom of a hill, is it?
No, incorrect. Top field.
Is it top field? Okay.
Yeah, the bottom field is a training ground / second ground.
Okay. Which you wouldn't know what it even looks like, you know what I mean?
So, no,
we definitely know it's a training ground. We played a Rezies game there.
Yeah.
But that's the only time we've... Yeah, we definitely don't train.
Realistically, next year, again, if you go up, is that going to change?
We would love it to change, but I dare say the policy now and the culture is we don't train.
Okay. So, I just don't even know. I want to try and unpack that a little bit.
So, hang on. In all fairness with that as well, let's unpack the last month. We've played Wednesday, Saturday, had a week off because it's rained, Saturday, Wednesday, and we're going again, right?
Mm-hmm.
With the average age of our first grade nearing 30, like we actually generally can't back up to train as well.
Yep.
We can't do a Saturday, Monday, Wednesday, Saturday. So... as long as we're match fit and the boys are healthy, we're competitive.
It's good. Yeah, fair enough. Well, let's talk about the next couple of weeks then, because there's a massive six-pointer that could very well, not even just in terms of what happens mathematically and on the table, but maybe in terms of motivation and belief. You've got a six-pointer against Tigers in 2 weeks to the day, you said. Now, that was meant to be played last week. It didn't happen. Tigers also came on this podcast and chatted about it and their motivations, because they are behind you guys. But, you know, a win in first grade could really, really bring things a lot closer. So, mentality going into that game, across all grades, but particularly reserves and first. I'll start with you because the microphone's in your hand again.
Sure thing.
That reserve grade team has not been in trouble much all year. Are you expecting that to be the same again when you do play them?
Look, so we played, we've done Quakers 4-1, 4-2, I believe, in Rezies. Look, first round, we did cruise, no disrespect to them. It was here, we did cruise past them. Second round, different story. We got up early, and they came back into the game. But we did score a couple late goals to get away with it.
Mm-hmm.
So I dare say it will be a tough game. Not as tough as first grade. That's two pretty evenly matched sides. And you know what, full credit to Tigers, because where they were this time last year compared to where they are today, it's been massive. I think last time we played Tigers last year, I think it was 9 or 10 nil on aggregate across the two games.
Yeah, it wasn't good.
So full credit to them. Like they've come a massive amount. They're well coached. They are super fit.
Mm-hmm.
My God, the boys hate chasing them.
Yeah.
So the boys hate chasing them.
I think that's
so.
What Eastern Creek have found. And again, no disrespect to Eastern Creek, but Eastern Creek have probably a similar sort of squad age average to you guys. And I just think they were outrun a couple of times. So
yeah, and I think Quaker's got a huge win over Oakville midweek last week too, 6-2 from what we've heard.
Yep.
But Oakville only getting two penalties there as well, so 6-0 really. But again, pace and fitness just ate Oakville.
You can't train at all in saying that, but not that it wouldn't bother you guys.
Correct,
Like their field is...
We feel for them. Like we were just saying in our group chat a couple of weeks ago, we've been in Blacktown, this is our second season, and I don't think in the whole time we've been there, Oakville's ever been at home. 2021 floods, then we lost the season, then they had the floods again this year, and it's happened again. So obviously on behalf of everyone at Prospect and us especially, like we do feel for all the people out there. But yeah, when we go to Quakers or we go to them, we actually have never played a Patterson Reserve ever either. So that's another one. When they came to us, they had a pretty vocal crowd from memory on the hill.
Mm-hmm. It's a big club.
Yeah, and look, it's no lie, we're friendly off the field, but both sides hate each other on it.
Yeah.
Simple as that.
That's
you know,
enough.
We play hard and there's always handshakes at the end, but I dare say it's a grand final in July.
Lee, if we pass to you, you should be, let's say 2 weeks that you're back to playing 90 minutes, fingers crossed for your sake. Are you ready for this game? Are you up for it?
Of course, mate. The whole team is, but we've got to play week by week. So we've got to get through Oakville this week and then we'll worry about Quakers the week after. I think we've got a Mitchamberry game before that as well. So that's one thing that we do well. We don't get ahead of ourselves. We didn't last year. We haven't this year. Rezies certainly haven't got ahead of themselves this year. I think they're about 12 or 13 points clear or something like that. We stay grounded, you know, because we need to stay grounded, otherwise we'll lose focus on the task ahead. And, you know, the task ahead is to get promotion. So we are within arm's reach. You know, last year it got taken away from us. It was a two-horse race, I would say. It was a little bit disappointing on our behalf. And, of course, Eastern Creek, we built up a good rivalry there. You know, the win last week against Creek sort of opened that gap up for us.
Yes.
You know, we went there with a plan, and we executed perfectly. I think that first half of first grade's game last week was probably the best half we've played all year. So, again, this week, we get through Oakville. We know what's coming. We know they've got some pace. They've got some big boys at the back. They've got some experience there as well. So we know exactly what we're in for this week. Then we go to Mitchinbury. And then we'll focus on Quakers. Mm. So, you know, we're close enough to what we want to get to. We've got to stay controlled. We've got to stay composed, and just keep going. Just keep going.
I've said this on a podcast already. When they featured about 3 weeks ago, plus on a match of the round stream that they were on around that time too. They lost their captain, who sits as their six. He's been replaced. He's out for the whole season, including finals. So he's also been replaced by someone who stepped up from the reserve grade level, who's slotted right in. He's been really good. So you guys would know all about that sort of interchanging of reserve players and 21s players into that first grade. So I'm sure you sort of understand how satisfying that is for them. I just want to bring it to Peter just to wrap this up for one last question. Realistically, when was the last time you guys actually trained?
they're not lying.
Actually, I don't think we even trained last year. Maybe we did like two sessions last year.
We really, look, pre-season was sort of off and on. If, you know, when I'm talking about out of the two squads, we'd lucky to get 8 or 9 there. We try to move from Tuesday to Thursday, from Tuesday to Thursday, we try to move it to Wednesday.
It
just got worse. So I said, guys, look, in all fairness, we're lucky we did have like midweek games, and that class was like a training session for us to keep fit. You know what I mean? But the guys, like the boy said, I mean, combined with the older heads and the younger heads, I mean, it's a good combination.
But realistically, how have you actually created combinations and learned how to set up for a set piece, or how to defend one, attack one, what to do on corners? How have you actually?
So if there's a free kick outside the box, Alex will kill someone just to take it. Okay. Okay. So I get your mention on there, Alex. Look, the majority of the boys have played with each other for a very long time. You know what I mean? So it's pretty simple for them what needs to be done. And the boys that have come into with the squad have actually gelled really well. Mm-hmm. And there's a mass understanding on what needs to be done.
Excellent.
You know, so, yeah, Alex.
It's the just back on the training thing. I think we know training's hard for us, so we owe it to each other and Chucky and Stan that we give 110% on game day. You know, it's hard for a lot of people to turn up to training. Some people are keen for it. Some people just can't do it with kids and work commitments. So, but when it comes to game day, we get there early.
Yes.
We warm up. We stretch. We do all the right things. And then we don't leave anything off. You know, everything stays on that field. Everyone gives 110%. There's no crap. You know what I mean? And that's because we can't commit to that training during the week. So, look, I think next year will probably be different. I don't think we'll be able to challenge for the title or get near the top four if we're not training or we don't pull our finger out. So that's something that we'll have to reassess in the off-season. But for now, what we're doing at the moment is working. And I think, you know, it will probably continue that way until the end of the year, and then we'll have to pull our fingers out.
It's kind of fitting that Tina Turner is simply the best is playing in the background. The Spartans are playing behind us here. Boys, I'm going to wrap this one up because I think that's just turned into... I thought this would be really serious. Yeah, we're here to win and, you know, Tigers would watch it and become sad. But the fact that you guys have just... I don't know what we talked about in the first two episodes about training.
We just,
you must have came up with something.
Do you want us to give a call out to the Tigers?
Sure, yeah.
George Tarkos is coming.
Coming for another goal of the week.
But no, we're looking forward to playing him. And yeah, it's going to be big end to the season.
If it's Wednesday night, I'll make sure that I reschedule everything that I do to make sure I'm there to watch it, because I'm really excited to see how it goes. I think it will decide what happens in terms of who goes up and who doesn't. But boys, it's been a pleasure to have you on. Thank you so much for coming on down. Appreciate it. Sorry, I thought you were going to ignore me there. You've been a pleasure particularly as well. And we'll see you guys soon. For our second segment here in the Blacktown Football Hour podcast, I'm joined by Jules Bombach, who is the coach of Quakers Hill Juniors Prem's side. He's featured a plethora of times already on the podcast. He's very experienced at doing his own podcast as well, of course. And he's someone who has been very good for saying things that have, I think, built a bit of healthy competition in our Deploy PL1. So it's great to see Quake is doing well, and they've performed really good this season, and they're going to be in the match of the round this weekend against against Workers, I should say. So I've got a couple of questions for Jules, which will be about, yes, this game coming up, yes, the final series as it's drawn even closer to when we last spoke, but also specifically about the last time we spoke, and that little bit of a pot stirring that he did while he was on here. So I'm sure he's drawing a wry smile across his face as we speak now, but it was a really good episode, and let's see if we can do something equally as entertaining and as purposeful here. So, Jules, thanks very much for joining us here.
Pleasure as always, mate.
Excellent. Appreciate you joining and coming on in post-work hours. I'm sure you've got plenty of things to do, but you're on here doing what you do best. So, look, my first question for you is in relation to... In fact, let's just talk about off the bat. The last time you and I spoke, you spoke about and your position on the table. You guys were first.
Yep.
Yes, Ponds had some game in hand.
Yeah.
And they've now capitalised on that, excuse me, and they've gone top. And they've performed really well since they've gone top as well. They haven't rested on their laurels at all. Seeing that happen and knowing what you said last time you were on here, which was pretty, you know, like I said, pot stirring, has that bumped your confidence at all? Or is that sort of, has that been talked about with the boys? Or is it literally just, these are our last couple of games, we're still going to keep pushing?
Not really. Look, to be honest, I mean, I look back at the episode because I was a bit, like, perplexed by the comments and that sort of thing. To be honest, I thought, if anything, it was really like giving them a compliment because, you know, I think the question was directed about if we feel any pressure and because we were sitting first, and fair enough question. But to be honest, it was, you know, like I said, if Ponds win their games in hand, they deserve to be top. The table does not lie, and they deserve to be where they are right now, which is top. They've been the most consistent team. They've beaten us twice this season. So... no, I don't think it backfired at all, or if I feel, you know, bad towards, or you know, bad about saying anything. I was asked the question, I gave a direct answer, and it's good. We just concentrate, obviously, on ourselves in terms of in-house. There's things that we can improve on, and this is obviously this season. We've got some lofty goals, but we've also got long-term goals as well. So it's all in. All instead, basically, yeah.
Because I think personally, if you'd have come out of that episode and watched it back, and your answer was something along the lines of, you know, Pond's a really good team, and you know, they'll deserve to go top, and we're expecting them to go top. If you hadn't have said what you said, which was more firming and backing yourself, I feel like that would have painted you in a sort of not weak, or but a little bit standoffish, and just happy to be there.
Yeah.
And be in that position at that point of the season, which was about the midway point. So I feel like that answer was the best you could have given, even if they had the mathematical ability to jump above you, which they did. So I think that painted you in the most formidable way possible. But yeah, sure, it caused a bit of a stir, but I don't think it was that bad at all. It's just healthy competition, like we said.
That's good.
You mentioned lofty expectations there as well.
Yep.
In terms of the rest of the season, you guys are actually sitting in fourth now, but there's games to catch up and things to happen.
Yep.
Everyone's run into the end of the season is very different as well. Marion would know that best with their run-in. Is it still the goal, like you said last time, to finish first, get two trophies, have that sort of safety net that does come with finishing first, or is that adjusted now a little bit?
Oh, look, I think control the controllable. I think that's the biggest thing. It's something that, you know, I've heard other coaches say, and I really firmly believe in it as well. What we can do is win the games that we have. That's all we can do, and take it one game at a time. If we do that, the lowest will finish a second. So anything else is outside of our hands. If it happens, it happens. That's fantastic for us, obviously. But yeah, like you said, everybody's got a little bit of a different run in and different challenges along the way. We're somewhat lucky in the sense that we don't have an additional catch-up game to do. So we've only got 5 games left. I believe it's all over the shop, right? Because some teams have played more than others, and it is what it is. But yeah, look, it's going to be a tough run in for everybody, especially with the vehicle. Schedule congestion. So yeah, we just control what we can control. Take one game at a time, and where we'll be at the end of season, we'll make do with, and go into the final season with confidence.
Now, you mentioned control the controllable, and of course, that's what you should be doing and aiming to do. One thing you can't control is the heavenly downpour that we've suffered through in recent weeks.
Yeah. Yep.
Now, there are teams that I've played for or have known of that have booked very expensive sessions on, you know, local synthetic pitches to go along with the wet weather. I don't know what you guys have done. It's not a question I've actually asked many teams in recent weeks, but you guys haven't played since June 25. That's 1 month and 2 days, if my memory is correct. What have you guys done in the last month and a bit?
Yeah, look, it's been, unfortunately, like you said, it's out of our control to a large extent. We have been able to get some sessions on, which has been great because, you know, the grounds have been open sporadically, and yes, we've been on some artificial at times as well. But it hasn't been to the extent of which we'd probably like. And, you know, at the end of the day, it's when you've got this much weather, it's affecting, you know, multiple, you know, people in the association and outside the association as well, in rival associations. So there's not as much supply as there is demand for these artificial turf pitches at times. So, yeah, look, it's been a challenge, I'm not going to lie. But and being a month and 2 days out from our last competitive game, obviously it's going to put us, you know, a little bit back, I think, in all honesty. But I think the players, one thing it probably has done is reinvigorate their desire. Everybody's just chomping at the bit to get back out there. Absolutely, so it's good.
In terms of what you did at the start of the season with looking at training and periodization and macro planning, that sort of thing, when the rain comes and knocks out a whole bunch of training sessions, when you do get those, and the great word you use, I think it's perfect to describe, sporadic training sessions and sporadic field openings, is it about keeping your physical condition, your fitness? Do you go in there and try and get the ball to feet? Like, how do you actually then, with that so much time off, try and maintain what you were doing?
It's pretty difficult, to be honest, just with how we play as well. I think the style of play that I like to adopt, and the team's all behind it, it's just very difficult in terms to sustain that for a lengthy period of time in a game when you've had almost a month off effectively from a competitive match. I mean, training's fantastic, but it's not game fitness. It's completely different. So yeah, look, it's a consideration moving forward in terms of what we do, how we do it, and at what times. So we may have to look at other alternative situations or solutions to a problem that with regards to just minutes in the legs. But the good thing is that we've got a really good depth in the squad, and the lads have been still doing their own stuff as well, which is good.
Yeah, excellent. Now, last question about previous games, and then we'll look at the present and the future a bit more. Your last game that you played on that 25th of June was actually a loss 2-1 to the ever-improving Doonside team, coached by Glenn Zwerb, who I know you know a lot about, of course. I have a lot of respect for as well, and Doonside are kind of having an opposite sort of season to Marion. Now, I'm sure you're all over the table in results. So Marion have basically lost to every top team and beaten, destroyed everybody who's not in the finals contention. Doonside seem to be the opposite, the sort of Robin Hood, the giant killers who then have struggled when perhaps the pressure's not on them as much. Doonside specifically, can you cast your mind back to that match and how 2-1 is on the scoreboard, but how sort of close was that game?
It was an interesting game. Conceded very early on with the first attack, long ball over the top, and
that would frustrate you or not?
Yeah, a little bit. But I mean, look, it's we're sort of behind the eight ball. Then you're chasing a game, and I think Doonside were really really good in terms of what they did against us, which is just sit a little bit deeper and sort of invite a little bit of pressure, but at the same time that then, you know, makes us, you know, more vulnerable on the counter attack. And, you know, I think that was, you know, they had a game plan. I think they really executed it perfectly. And it's funny, it's very, it was almost like a battle of two teams that were trying to employ the same tactics. I went and watched Doonside and Workers, and that was a really good game. It was I wouldn't say boring, but it was very like a game of chess up until like the last 10 minutes, and then it just exploded. So, yeah, look, that game, obviously frustrating to lose, our first home loss of the season, which we weren't obviously too happy about. But the good thing is that it sort of has got that monkey off our back, and we can just go, okay, look, let's just take it one game at a time. Yes, we've, you know, lost against Doonside, but they're beating a lot of top teams at the moment. They're doing really, really well. And they've got this sense of belief, I just sense from looking at them, that, you know, they believe in every game, particularly against the top five side at the moment, that they can win. So,
absolutely.
Yeah.
I get what you mean by monkey off the back, and this is the weirdest example, but I have to throw it in. I was playing Football Manager today, and I had an unbeaten streak 22 games into the Premier League season with Arsenal, and then we lost a game to Crystal Palace of all teams, three seasons into the career mode,
yeah.
And then all of my players' morale dropped because apparently that was a lot of pressure. So I get that. And obviously Football Manager is just as real as real life.
It's reality.
So, yeah. I want to speak about the match of the round and the most recent one that we had, which is a fortnight ago, where Workers featured, of course. They also had a big win late on, which shows that they can do it throughout
great
the time.
Great celebration as well,
it
by
was,
the way.
It was. It was a killer. Great. It really was. Brandon Ford, if you're watching along, you've got this man's approval.
Yeah.
I know you've watched the game. Is there anything you're going to take from that and try and stop? Is it set pieces wise, or is it not leaving somebody unmarked in the back post at the 86, 87 minute mark? What can you take from that game?
It's a really weird game. I watched most of it. I thought Marion were applying a lot of pressure, particularly in the first half. And it came really close. Keep at it. Fantastic game. So yeah, look, it's something that we've sort of sat back, or I certainly have, and watched and sort of looked at. Maybe we can look at capitalising on a couple of different areas where we could create mismatches. But in all seriousness, Workers are a very good team. We had a match of a round against them two months ago, something like that, and drew 1-1, and that was a really good
game.
Yeah, it was good. It was a physical encounter, but like very respectful, and it'd be good to face them as well with our full 11. I think arguably the best player in the league, George Pagnai, wasn't there. I'd love to see what he can do against a really good team defensively as well. So yeah, it'd be interesting to see what happens on Saturday. That's for sure.
For sure. Now, I know that you think that this might cause a stir as well in a different sort of way, but it's a fourth match of the round that Quakers feature in. That was the very first one, and now towards the latter stages, you're getting another one. It is, however, the first one that you've had at home, certainly in the entire time I've been here, and what you said as well, it's the first time since live streams have started through the BDSFA TV, social medias, that it's going home to Quakers Juniors. So what can you tell us about... Is there an extra bit of hype behind that, I think? Because I know you guys have been wanting this for a while.
Yeah, I'm thrilled that we've got this. We've really wanted it at the start of the season. It didn't look like it was going to happen originally, just with how the scheduling happened, and that's fine. But to be able to get this now, especially at this time of the season, I think that adds to it, just because it is so tight at the top. If results, go the way of which maybe the table would reflect, then... it could come down to the wire in terms of even jostling for second, third, fourth, fifth spots. So it's really exciting. We can't wait to have the live stream there. As you said, first time that we've had it at Quakers Hill Park. The club are trying to get as many people down there, and it'd be great to see everybody down there in green and white, similar to what we had with the Oz Cup game. That would be brilliant.
Yeah. Excellent. Yeah, they had I'd say probably 400, maybe 300, 400 people on a Wednesday or... Was it Wednesday night at
Thursday
Valentine?
Night.
Thursday night. Sports Park against Sydney United.
which is fantastic. I was one of those two, not quite in the green and white, but I was there. My last question, which is the hardest one of all to answer, is how are you going to pick them apart and how are you going to beat them?
I think the main thing, and it's sort of not to give a vanilla answer or anything like that, but it is really about what we do. What we do, and instead of what they do or what, you know, their strengths are.
Right, so rather than reactive sort of
thing. Yeah, exactly. That's right. And that's one of our, I guess, our fundamental philosophies as well, as being proactive. So the players know that. And yeah, look, it's going to be tough in terms of, obviously, I think particularly the first maybe 10, 15 minutes, just to get into the rhythm of a game again is going to be something that we need
to
be
more.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. And that's the thing, is that I think that in terms of, if you're looking at it from a perspective, if, you know, if Sportsbet was looking at the markets on this one, you know, I'd probably put them favourites potentially because of having a little bit more football in the legs. They've been fantastic away from home as well. So
undefeated.
Yeah, undefeated away from home.
Not sure what it is.
Yeah, yeah.
But
especially with that facility as well. Like, it's
nice.
Beautiful facility that they have there. So, yeah, it's interesting, but hopefully we can try and do our best to break that duck.
Jules, thanks very much for coming on here. Really
thanks,
appreciate
mate.
It.
Pleasure as always. Cheers.
Bye-bye.
Well, how entertaining are those prospect boys? It'll be great to see them in the Deploy PR1 next year, as it will be equally as great to see Quakers Tigers or even Eastern Creek if they make a late mad dash, but that's looking more unlikely considering the prospect in Eastern Creek had recently just played and prospect took the victories in those games. So, as well, Quakers Juniors, you will see them against Workers, who didn't feature because they featured last week, in the match of the round this weekend, Saturday, 6 p.m. Of course, I'll be there to commentate it. I can't wait to have you guys all there. And like I said, fingers crossed that the rain stays away. I would show you a goal of the week in this segment, but unfortunately, no games went ahead. So I can't give a goal of the week, which is a bit of a shame, but you might have picked that up already. There will most certainly be goals of the week to put forward this week, provided that all games go ahead. Andrew, you're still here.
Yep.
I'm not going to make you sit here in complete silence while I do the art show. So, what can I bring in here? Oh, can you just do one thing for me? Can you please just say cue the outro music?
Cue the outro music.
Like and subscribe, everybody. Thanks so much for being here, and we'll see you next week. Goodbye.